We're lucky. We're back on the author trail again. And we've got a great author, Kenton Kilgore from Kent Island. Thank you for being with us, okay?
Thank you.
And we did this interview 10 years ago.
Something like that.
And my son said they lost it on the computer or something.
Right, right, right.
That will not happen this time, okay? I promise you, okay? Because my son's in charge now, so gotcha. I got it made. Kenton, how about tell everybody a little bit about yourself before we get into these lovely books?
Well, my name is Kenton Kilgore. Some people ask, is that my real name or is that a pen name? No, that actually
it's
is
a
my
great
real name.
It's a great name.
I live on Kent Island. I've been living there since 98, but my family has been out on Kent Island since 1984. I grew up mostly in Maryland, around the suburbs of D.C.
I grew up in Montgomery County.
I grew up in Prince George's County in Greenbelt. I went to Eleanor Roosevelt High School.
I went to Walt Whitman, right around the Beltway from me. Oh, yep. So you're D.C. We're D.C. guys.
That's right.
Let me ask you, are you a Washington football team guy?
Not anymore. No. Been a while.
Is that a disaster? The Titanic, too, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, so you grew up in P.G. County.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Been here for quite a while.
Yeah, I went to the University of Maryland and had a lot of great teachers there.
When?
Yeah. 88.
Okay, 88. I graduated in 74. Had a good experience at Maryland?
Yeah, okay. Loved it there.
There's 40,000 people there. It was a good school. It was a
very
good school.
Very big school.
Now, what did you do after Maryland?
After Maryland, I got married and soon had some kids, and then I just spent the whole 90s just with my head down working a variety of jobs. I thought I was going to teach college, and I was trying to get into that. Once I started doing that, I realized I didn't like it.
That's not what you wanted to do.
No.
Teaching is like being a priest. It's a calling.
Yep.
And you know what? It's a tough job. That's why those who survive it, bless them, right?
Yep. So then I became a criminal, and I went to work for the United States government.
Come on. Thank you for your service with the government. Uncle Sam, what did you do?
Since 2007, I've been working with the Federal Railroad Administration.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
In railroad safety.
Oh, very good.
And working to keep people safe, keep trains safe. And,
okay.
Yeah.
Now, we're all going to high speed. What's the status of the high-speed train in California? Do you know?
I'm not sure if they're going to do it or not.
No, we're not going to do it.
A couple years back, I think they said they were going to kill it. I don't know if they're going to bring it back. But
I mean, the idea you go from San Francisco to L.A. in an hour or a couple hours sounds awful good to me. Because I made that. Now, let's jump ahead.
Sure.
You've got one daughter, I think I'm correct.
Two.
One out in California, speaking of California. You have two daughters.
Right.
But you have one out in California.
Right.
And tell us a little bit. That's a nice story. Go ahead.
Well, she went to Kent Island High School, graduated in 2017, went to Catholic University, studied pre-law there, basically. And she's in a teaching program.
Through the University of Notre Dame, you told
Through the University of Notre Dame.
Terrific.
And she's out there teaching fourth grade. At a school in Santa Ana, California,
good for her.
Right next
thank
to Anaheim.
Thank you for doing it. Most important, besides writing, the most important profession in the world.
It's more important than writing.
Now, how long will she be out in California?
She'll be out there for 2 years.
Well, good. Yeah. And get out there as often as you can.
Yes, yes.
It's November 19th. It's windy. I'd be delighted to take her lunch if you'd like. Okay, all right. Now, Ken, let's switch gears a little bit. Let's talk about your books. Why don't you review, like you did before we went on the air, the order of the books, kind of what they're about, and most importantly, every time you talk about a book, tell us how we can get them.
Okay. Well, certainly. I actually started writing stories in fourth grade.
In fourth grade?
I had a teacher who, as our weekly assignments, every Friday we would either have to write a journal entry.
This is in PG County?
No, this was actually back in Phoenix, Arizona, where I lived before.
Okay.
Yeah. Before I came out to Maryland when I was 13.
Oh, wow.
Before then, my family lived in Phoenix, Arizona, and various places.
Phoenix. Nice all year round. Oh,
yeah.
How did you do it, Kent?
And anyway, my teacher, every Friday, we would either have to write a journal entry or we'd have to write a short story.
Oh, very good.
Well, you know, the lives of fourth graders aren't that interesting, so I never liked doing the journal entry stuff, but I did like writing short stories. So I started writing in fourth grade. I wrote my first novel when I was 11.
11?
And
Is it published?
No. It's a Star Wars ripoff.
It was self-published.
Yeah,
I say it was self-published.
It was written on notebook paper and pencil. So, and I basically, you know, never stopped. I just kept on writing.
It's a love.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And then when my girls were younger, I started writing them a bedtime story about two sisters who find a dragon.
Let me just interrupt.
Sure.
What was your first novel? I know it was, but what was that about? Do you remember what it was about?
Oh, yeah.
What was it about?
It was basically a ripoff of Star Wars. Star Wars had come out the summer before.
Sci-fi type thing.
Yeah, cool. I've always written sci-fi or fantasy or horror. Okay. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. So the bedtime story I started writing for my girls, it started off as a very simple story about two sisters who find a dragon. Oh. And as they got older, the story got bigger and bigger and bigger until it eventually became this.
This is your first book.
Right. This is my first published book, Dragon Tamer's Daughters. And I like to describe it as it's like Little House on the Prairie with dragons.
Okay. Kids are going to love it. Kids are going to love it.
Yeah, I've had kids as young as 9 read it. If they can read Harry Potter, they can read this. It's kind of a thick book. It's about 400 some odd pages.
But suitable for adults, too.
Yeah. About half of my... I write young adult sci-fi and fantasy, but about half of my readers, if not more, are adults anyway. Right. I think they get a lot out of it.
And the basic story is, like you said...
The basic story is these two girls are living in an alternate Old West.
And these are your daughters in disguise.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
They're pretty much based on them. And they find this little dragon that's been hurt in a fight with another dragon. Oh. They take the dragon home, and, you know, the big questions are, can they save the dragon's life, and can the dragon save them and their family from all the problems they're having? Because their family has a lot of problems. For openers, their father is an outlaw who's wanted for a crime he didn't commit. And he's being hunted
by... So people are chasing him, bounty hunters.
Yeah, bounty hunters and the troops of the local governor. And they're poor. They live out in the middle of nowhere. They have to conceal their identities.
Where is it? Did you name a state?
No. It's a fictional sort of... a fictional Old West.
Okay.
Yeah. So that came out in 2012.
Is it still public? Can you get it if you want?
You can get all these through Amazon.
Oh, just go right to Amazon.
Right.
Type your name in.
Type my name in. There are only 3 Kenton Kilgores in the United States, and I'm the only one who writes.
So you're on Amazon. That's real easy.
Yeah, it's very easy. Yeah, and they're in Kindle and soft cover,
and
like you see.
But it's still in print.
You can get these.
So that
anytime.
Was number one.
Right, that was number one.
And that's probably your two daughters' favorite books.
I think they like it a lot.
We'll do a later interview with them. Yeah. I'll get the real scoop.
Well, the daughter who's out in California teaching, she says she's going to be reading parts of this to her students.
Great. So second generation.
Right,
excellent.
Right.
Job well done.
Yeah.
So you followed, how this was done, how many years ago?
This came out in 2012, and it came out in 2 volumes, but I've revised it and put it into one volume in 2015.
So that was your first one.
Right.
We went from dragons to...
Lost Dogs is my second one. It is by far my most popular one.
And the last time we talked, I think that was published.
Yeah.
Yes.
It is about... Two dogs on Ken Island.
Actually taking place
on Ken Island. Most of it's set in Bay City, actually.
Okay.
And it's about two dogs, a German Shepherd, like you see on the cover. His name's Buddy. And he lives with a beagle mix named Sally.
That's the name of my grandchildren's dog. So you sold one copy.
Boom, right there off the bat. So the end of the world comes suddenly on a summer afternoon. All the people are gone and the dogs are left behind. And
it's just dogs.
Just the dogs. All the people are gone. And the story, it becomes a survival story told from the point of view of Buddy. So you get inside his head what he hears, smells, feels, thinks, as he tries to reunite with his human family.
Okay. Who is still alive or no?
Well, I can't.
Don't want to destroy it. Oh, come on!
I can't spoil that for you.
Okay, all
right.
Oh, that. And now, will people who read it recognize things in Ken Island?
Absolutely.
Oh, they will. Okay.
Yeah. If you live on Ken Island and you read
this book, maybe a landmark or so.
You will never ever see the food line the same way again. Because at one point the dogs make it to the food line.
That could get ugly.
No, it's very good for them.
It's a survival thing.
That's right, yeah.
And again, we can get that on Amazon.
That's on Amazon, too.
Print, no problem.
Yep.
Number 3.
It's very popular because dog lovers just love this book.
I can see that.
They eat it up. And then my latest one, this came out a couple years ago, it's called This Wasted Land, and it's just... what can I say? It's dark, it's scary, okay. it's violent, it's gory, it's a horror
story. What are you talking about, 2021 here, Ken? What are you doing?
Oh, it's a horror story, and
give me a little bit,
part
give
of it's set on Ken Island. Okay. It's about two teenagers on Ken Island. The main character is a girl named Alex, and she's a misfit, she's a troublemaker, she has all kinds of emotional problems.
Okay.
She's had anger management issues. She's a hard sort of case. She likes vintage heavy metal. She likes motorcycles. You know, she's kind of a wreck. She's kind of a wreck. And her boyfriend Sam is a good kid, but he has issues of his own. He's kind of a misfit too. Well, come to find out that a witch abducts Sam, snatches him
on Ken Island.
Actually, it's in Centerville here where it happens.
In Centerville, okay.
Yeah, they're driving through Centerville. Something happens.
I can tell you where it was that night. It wasn't
it wasn't you?
Okay.
And Alex goes to get him back, and they all wind up in this dark, gray, gloomy desert, this wasted land that's like littered with all kinds of like trash and broken things and lost objects and missing people and things like that. It's a dark, scary place filled with monsters like you've never seen before. Mm-hmm. Like no zombies, no werewolves, no ghosts. These are monsters like you've never read in any book or seen in any movie.
So you got to read the book just to meet some new monsters.
And after you read chapter 3, you will never use a public restroom ever again.
So guaranteed. Food line is in trouble, public restroom.
Food line in this one, no public restrooms after this wasted land.
You mentioned Centerville. Are there any Centerville landmarks in
it? Most of the action takes place on 213 in Centerville. They're driving through Centerville and something happens.
Right.
They have to take a detour that ends up badly.
So you are a local author that incorporates the local facilities again. Well, great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good Christmas presents.
Excellent. If you have a reader that you know, then these are right up their alley. If they like fantasy stories, sci-fi stories, scary stories. I tell parents that if these were movies, because I get that question all the time: is this appropriate for my child?
Scary? Yeah.
And I tell parents, if these were movies, this would be like PG-13.
Okay.
No, I'm sorry. No, this would be a PG movie. Okay.
Right.
There's some mild language. There's some violence with like dragons fighting each other, things like that. Nothing too terrible.
Older
teenagers.
That wouldn't be a problem.
No. No problem. Lost Dogs is more sort of PG-13.
Okay.
It's a little bit darker, a little bit scarier. There are dogs fighting each other. I mean, it plays
more
a little rough sometimes.
More adults and older kids, Brad.
Yeah.
Okay.
This Wasted Land is definitely for 15 and up. It is definitely, it's scary. It has a lot going on with
good sci-fi stuff. I mean, people like Jeff Strait are gonna love it.
Oh,
right?
Probably. Okay. This is more sort of along the lines of like Stephen King, Dean Koontz, Clive Barker, H.P. Lovecraft.
Who everybody loves.
All the classic sort of horror authors. So it's dark, it's scary, it's violent, it has monsters. It plays really rough, so it's not for younger kids.
Okay, but
not
the sci-fi crowd is going to love it, especially when you talk about monsters like they've never seen before.
They've never seen before.
This will be great. And Lost Dogs sounds like more of a... Anybody can read that? To the heart type story, dogs surviving.
Yeah, and dog lovers especially love it because I did a lot of research on this book to figure out dogs, and to portray them. And what I've learned is, you know, we tend to think of dogs as they're just pets, they just lie around the house all day, whatever. Dogs are actually amazingly complex animals
that are thinking this whole time.
Yeah, and they're designed, by nature, and they've evolved into these magnificent predators and creatures. They have senses that
are
far beyond ours.
They give us unconditional love, which is unbelievable.
Some of them do,
Some of them do.
And a lot of the dogs' personalities. There are lots of dogs in this book. Lots of characters, and a lot of their personalities are derived from their breeds.
Okay.
As you might imagine,
do you have a golden doodle in that one, by any chance?
There's a golden setter in there.
Okay.
I think. Right.
Same neighborhood.
But like for example, one of the major characters is a border collie named Rex.
Okay.
Okay. And border collies, as I learned in my research for this book, are incredibly intelligent. They're probably the smartest dog out there. There's a case of a border collie that's been studied by National Geographic, that the border collie knows 300 separate words.
300.
Okay. And a lot of
50 ahead of me.
That's right. So they're very intelligent. They're actually very agile, and they're very high energy, and so that comes across.
Do you have a dog?
Oh yeah, I have two dogs.
Oh, you have two. What do you
have? I have two dogs. Well, we have a sweet little pug at home who is my wife's baby. His name's Frankie.
And totally spoiled, I can tell.
Oh yeah. Okay. He's just a sweet little boy, and then we have what we call our house wolf. we have a big Anatolian Shepherd named Sheba. Lord.
This is a big dog.
She's pretty tall. She's about this tall, about 80 pounds, and she's a Kangal, which is a breed of Turkish guard dog that use to protect
The king or the queen or something.
Sheep and goats.
To protect sheep and goats.
Right.
Let other animals get near them.
Right.
Or humans probably.
Right. So she's
very protective.
Very protective. Very smart. Very fast. Very tough.
Ken, I found we have this golden doodle. It will only be a year old in November. This dog is smarter than we are. I mean, gets me up at 5 o'clock in the morning. My alarm clock can't get me up at 5 o'clock, but he does. When we go outside, he knows his territory. He knows what he wants to do and when he wants to do it. And inside, I surrender. What do you want? Obviously, that lost dogs would be a great. If your dog loves like I do,
it has over 100 five-star reviews on Amazon. Dog lovers love this book.
How did you research it? Did you just online research? Or
a lot of reading books. There's my primary source was a nonfiction book by Andrea Horowitz called Inside a Dog, where she talks about sort of the anatomy, physiology of dogs' behavior, how they sense things. You know, the major sort of thing about dogs is that, our primary sense is sight.
Right. I see
right.
You give me visuals the whole time.
Sure, sure. If you look around this room,
the clock, the lights, everything.
You notice there are millions of bits of information streaming into your eyes every second about, shapes, colors, textures, patterns, whatever. A dog's primary sense is scent, is smell.
Smells, right.
So they get the same amount of information pouring into their nose every second as we do through our eyes. Now, it's not the same type of information.
But they process, their brain processes.
But there's just as much coming in. And really, the only sort of limitations on them is what do they want to pay attention to? So a dog can smell, obviously can smell the difference between you and me. That's easy.
Sure.
They can smell like where you've been on your clothes. They can smell what you had for dinner. They can smell how you're feeling. They can smell if you're illness. What I mean?
Imagine if a dog could write a book.
Right.
It'd be an amazing thing.
Yeah.
Well, I know with my dog, it knows when my wife's coming home.
Mm-hmm.
I think blocks away. I can't prove it.
Because their sense of hearing is so tremendously better than ours.
Yeah.
They can hear sounds, of course, that are higher than we can hear, the famous dog whistle thing, right? But they can also hear sounds that are much lower than we can hear. So a dog will know when a thunderstorm's coming
Way before.
So if your dog starts acting nervous and pacing around the house and you're thinking, what's the problem? Give it about 10 minutes and the thunderstorm shows up.
Just another second, we'll go back to me. I know with my dog at 5 o'clock in the morning, it smells or hears a deer.
Mm-hmm.
Probably 1 to 2 minutes before I have any idea. We have a big field behind our house.
Absolutely.
Neighbors moving,
it's
amazing.
Their senses are that good.
All that
goes into that book.
Okay, yeah. So dog lovers, you've got to get lost dogs.
Absolutely. And there's a sequel coming out next spring.
Talk about that, please.
Well. I put this out a few years back and people kept asking me, this book is great.
Yeah.
What about cats?
Oh, wow.
And so I thought about it for a while and I'm like, okay, so I'm coming out with a book next spring called Stray Cats, which is kind of a sequel spinoff of Lost Dogs. And in fact, the cat appears in this book. The cat also appears in this Wasted Land.
What's the cat's name? Is that name?
The cat's name is Pimmy.
Pimmy. Very good. Pimmy's going to be a star soon.
That's right. And she is she's a black cat, and she appears in both these books.
Oh, great.
And as a matter of fact, stuff from some of the dogs from Lost Dogs appear in this book, and some of the stuff from here appears in this book. They all sort of cross over.
So you can go from book to book with some of the same characters.
They're they're standalone books, but they do have elements that cross over. So if you read more than one, you can recognize things the other and say, like, hey, I know that.
Into that
kind
person.
Of like Easter eggs, right? And with Stray Cats, it's going to sort of incorporate all three of those things, and it has a whole new different direction. It's basically 9 short stories woven around a central story and all featuring this cat Pimmy.
Okay. Yeah. And this is coming out in the spring.
In the spring, and cat lovers will love it.
Will Amazon have that in the spring?
Amazon will have that too.
Let me ask you, a couple easy questions.
Sure.
As an author, mm-hmm. I mean, what makes you write? Were you sitting at dinner with the kids, or you were telling stories to the kids, and it said, Daddy, that's going to be a book. I can explain.
Right.
How about, mm-hmm. Where did they come from?
For Lost Dogs, I was dog sitting for my parents' dogs several years back, and I was just hanging around the house with them. My folks were away on a trip, and I'm hanging out with their dogs. I idly flip on the TV for something to do, so I hang out with. And a show comes on the History Channel called Life After People. That was a series that was on several years ago.
Planet, right.
The premise was, you know, what would happen to the planet if we just sort of disappeared one day? How long would the lights stay on? How long would your car start, et cetera? One segment, it was only about 4 minutes or so, was what would happen to your pets without us?
Would they survive, yeah.
Right. And so I watched that segment, and I thought, I could really take this and run with
end
it.
End of the world.
So I did, right. So that's where that
came
from.
That came from a TV show.
That came from a TV show.
How about the
Wasted Land was, I actually started writing this basic story in my senior year of college in 1988.
Really? Has it been in the mind that long?
You're right, right. The germ of the idea was there, and at in college, I took a lot of Norse mythology, and I was studying, you know, fantasy and science fiction there, and all those ideas sort of percolated. I tried to write it back then, didn't work. Picked it up again, didn't work.
The time wasn't there.
Right, wasn't there. So, but then after I published Lost Dogs, I thought to myself, I think I have the chops to finally do this story justice. And
it was your time.
On one level, it's a horror story.
I can't wait to do the monsters and
I
think it's gonna be interesting.
You know, on one level, it's that, but it has like all sorts of other layers. Okay. It's sort of a Smith Island cake of a book.
Oh, I love a Smith Island cake. Right. I know I'm gonna love the book.
So there's all kinds of stuff in there. References to like Viking history, Norse legends, an ancient Hindu poem.
Oh, this is good.
The Baltimore Ravens. Motorcycles.
We're DC guys. No Ravens. Come on.
I'm teasing. The NFL. There's all kinds of just things thrown in there. For example, like my teenage heroine there, Alex. She's a fan of hard rock.
Okay.
All the chapter titles are
after musicians or something.
No, they're named from titles of hard rock songs.
Oh, wow.
Especially Led Zeppelin.
So fans are going to love this.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, the title comes from a Led Zeppelin song.
Oh, very creative. Very good. Yeah. Now, Ken, we're about out of time. So let's review with everybody.
Okay.
First of all, you can just go to Amazon.com, type on Kenton Kilgore, and pick a book, and all three of them are available now.
Oh, yeah.
Sounds like a perfect holiday gift, right?
Definitely.
And it brings in even Centerville on 213,
that's
wasteland. Okay. And it brings in Kent Island.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of local connections.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sci-fi people are going to like it.
Yeah.
Music people are going to like
it,
right? So you've got all types of goodies going on.
Sure.
Well, this is great stuff. Now I'm going to ask you the toughest question you have faced in years.
What's that?
Is there any hope for the Washington football team?
I think no. And you know, it's kind of funny, sort of sad, is that this season is the 30th anniversary of their last Super Bowl.
Oh, I know.
And season, right? When they went 14-2.
There'll be no champagne this year.
No, probably not. Well, but that last game against the Buccaneers is something else, right?
Who would have thought, right? Well, look, please tell your daughter in California, I wish her all the luck in the world, noble profession, go to law school when she's done, okay?
And my other daughter, the older one, she turns 28 today, so happy birthday.
I'd sing happy birthday, but Jeff Strait will throw something at me, okay? Please, if you have a second and you're looking for something to give for the holidays, Kenton Kilgore, 3 wonderful books out. You can go to Amazon. I think the easier way, just go to your name. Just type on Kenton Kilgore. The 3 books will come up. Local talent, local background. It's just going to be terrific. Kenton, thank you for coming up on a very windy, chilly November. Sure. Tell your daughter she's looking smart, the one in California, okay?
All right.
Thank you for coming. Oh, and by the way, please, do this publicly. Please, you and all the authors out there, love local authors to come in and your chances to share with us what is obviously great stuff, okay? Right. I'm going to beat you home and get on Amazon,
gotcha.
Okay?
All right.
I'm Fred McNeil. Thank you. My time is up. Thank you for your time. We're going to see you next time, and I'm going to sneak this book when he's not looking.